Then the other challenge that we have, or another, the other element of the context is the massive poverty that we have. I mentioned India is not a poor country, but India is a land of poor people. Many poor people, many malnourished people, more than the people in the undeveloped African countries. Wouldn't imagine. Life standard is better in some of the poorest African countries than in India for many people. Can you imagine that our people, whom we saw here in the village, they live most often with the 25 rupees per day at their hands for expense, 25 rupees per day. I'm not saying just if from my mind, I'm not making up. I have had last year's exposure camp experience. We have talked with the people and calculated together with the people the income they get in 365 days, divided it by 365 days, and divided it further according to the number of people in the family. And so we came to understand the money they have for expense on one person one day, that is in many cases 25 rupees. Few years ago it was 6 rupees, 7 rupees. Now last year it's 25 rupees. Some families 50 rupees. Some families go a little further higher and so on. Can you live on 25 rupees per day here in the seminary? Do you think you are living at 25 rupees per day? You are all paying at least 3,000-4,000 rupees per month. That means 150 rupees per day. So where is 100 rupees, 150 rupees and 25 rupees? This 25 rupees is for all their expenses, not for food alone. Expenses including medical expense, festival celebration expense, then maintenance expense, all the other different expenses. Most of their money goes for eating, surely, but then little expenses in this time. So 25 rupees or even low is the standard of the ordinary people here. But then the richest people, Ambani, Adani and so on, every moment, every minute, they earn millions of rupees. Imagine the wealth they have. This is the contrast. Majority of the people live in poverty, but 1% of Indian population has more than around 50% of the wealth of the country. This may not be exactly accurate, but then this is more or less the picture for you to have an understanding. In this context of poverty, what do we say about God's revelation? What is the purpose of God revealing? What could be the reason why God comes into the world as we believe? In the Old Testament, into the life of the Jews, afterwards the fullness of God's coming into the world was realized in the person of Christ. So what is the meaning of this revelation? What is the purpose of this revelation? What is the meaning of living, giving a response to this revelation? What is the meaning of living faith, living faith today? The context determines. We have to reflect in the background of this context with the courage and with sincerity and openness to the Bible and the Word of God, and in contact with the context or the situation, we have to live in this world where many people are Hindus, many people are poor, many people are rich. In this world, we have to live our faith meaningfully. Therefore, we have to reflect about all these things in contact with the source of our faith is Bible, in contact with that, then our living situation. We cannot live in an air bubble, simply practice our faith as if these things were not so. We are people, we are living among people, so we have to take into consideration these realities. So the context of poverty, atheism, it's another. Atheism is a denial of God. We Christians have a tradition of decrying the lack of faith of the atheists. They have no faith, that is against the truth and so on. But then you examine the life of the atheist, the life of a Christian. Christian has got faith and he lives his faith, and try compare that life with the life of the atheist. Sometimes he lives just like a Christian lives, sometimes even better than a Christian. Christian, to be Christian means to anticipate what I am going to say, to live according to the pattern of life of Jesus, live the death and resurrection like Jesus. We must live like Jesus, look at the world like Jesus looked, live in the world like Jesus lived. That is Christianity. And this Christianity would bring in the world the kingdom of God. That was the plan of Jesus. He preached the kingdom of God. Today, the atheist, he sometimes is found to be better working in the direction of equality and justice and peace. Kingdom of God is that, no? On the contrary, sometimes the Christians, the Vatican II says, the atheism of the believers is more dangerous than the atheism of the atheists. They may be living a life in accordance with the Christian life. If that is so, the Christian who does not follow the way of life of Jesus is a greater harm than the atheist. Atheist is perhaps better. And Jesus said, prostitutes and tax collectors will be there before you, believing people. So today, in today's context, he would say, hey, atheists will go before, you will be at the end. So, just for kind of a change, I said this. So, the challenge that we have in reflecting about faith and revelation is now clear for you, I believe. I spoke also about the thought patterns of change about a phenomenological language. A little more I would like to speak about it. It is more connected with our present day language, is more connected with our life experiences, and it is existential. You heard the word existential, existential philosophy. Theology also is more existential. In the past, the theology was concerned about things, different things that are existing, and God as the highest reality. So realities, thinking about that. Now we speak in not in terms of things like that and realities like that. We speak in terms of persons. Today the philosophical thinking world is using not merely materialistic language or language of things and objects, but language of persons. What is more important, person or a thing? Person. So the language of person is used for understanding theology. Theology as personalistic, you may think of in that way. So, in this context, or in the background of this understanding, we can ask the question about meaning of revelation. A revelation comes from a Latin word, revelare. Revelare. Revelare means, you know the word reveal. Reveal means revelare. So the words, the consonants also are more or less the same. Reveal, revelare. So you understand the meaning. Originally, revelation means changing of or removing of the veil, removing of the veil that covers some reality. And revelation is humankind experiencing God. The veil covering God is dropped. And God comes out, let's say, God reveals himself. That is the experience of humanity. This can be understood in two ways. Revelation as a process, that is to say, God reveals himself and the process of his revealing himself. In the Old Testament, we have the witness of God watching, God seeing the people suffering. Then he comes down, asks Moses. This is a process of God revealing himself, God revealing his concern for the people, and God revealing himself as a person who is concerned about the people of Israel, a person who wants the freedom of the people of Israel, who wants the people to live and celebrate life on earth. Earthly life is not to be one of misery and slavery and suffering. He wants, or God reveals himself as someone who wants the people to celebrate life in freedom. If you are a slave, there is no joy in life. So, revelation is a process that is taking place. So we can understand revelation is this way, as a process. We can understand also revelation as the product. As a result of this process, we have some truths which we otherwise would not know. How do we know that God is loving and kind unless we have got experience of God in history, that he is loving and kind, he is having concern for the humanity, he wants people to live as full human beings in the world? How do we know unless we experience that? So now we know God as loving, you know, the truth. God has come, having come down to us, he has given self-gift, given himself to us, and he wants us to be united with him. After the experience of earthly life in communion with him in heaven, let's say. So that these are some truths. We know also God is one. God is Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit. And there are so many other teachings which the Catholic Church teaches. These are all truths. These are also revelations. So these are products. The other one is process. So two ways of understanding revelation. Revelation as process, revelation as product. And revelation can be also put in propositions. Proposition means word, sentences. Propose, make a sentence. So revelation can be propositional. Faith also can be propositional. That is to say, revelation and faith are formulated in terms of sentences. That is the object of, the product of revelation. So the process of revelation, then the product. Product can be expressed in propositional language. So these distinctions we have to keep in mind. Then we have personalistic understanding of revelation, where God reveals himself as a person interested in the others and the welfare of the others. And God is not only interested, God does guide the history in such a way that people begin to live fullness of life as free human beings, as brothers and sisters, and they worship him as Father. So a family life, God's family, where everyone else becomes brother and sister. That is in terms of person. You understand? This is not in terms of metaphysical, where is God, who is God, who did it and who made it, who is the maker and so on. Much more than that, it is based on the experience of revelation as personalistic in the Bible. So the experience of our Jewish forefathers, we have learned from that, and then we know God is in this way to be understood as a person. We are persons. So there is a personal relationship between God and us. So this personal relationship between God and us is both revelation and faith. When God reveals himself as person to us, God is revealing. Revelation is taking place in personalistic categories. And when we respond to Him as persons. That is to say, I am interested in the other person's happiness, realization of his plan, realization of his will. So I am interested in the other person. Who is the other person? God. So my faith as a response to revelation is a matter of personalistic understanding. How I live as a person, taking into consideration His will and plan for life, His will and plan for the world. So revelation becomes personalistic. Faith also becomes personalistic. Faith is something to be lived. Faith is not something to be merely kept in the head. Of course, there are things which we keep in the head, propositional, the product of revelation. God is one, God is three, these are all revealed to us. So these are propositional revelations or product revelations. These we keep in our mind, in the intellect. But keeping in the intellect is not relationship. Today we give importance to relationship, personalistic relationship with God. And how do you do the live the relationship? How do you love your parents? It is simply thinking of parents or by doing something for them. When they are sick, you take care of them. When they are in need for something, you take care of them. You express your relationship through actions, right? Not merely by thinking, I love my parents. Oh. That is the old understanding of metaphysical kind of thinking, where faith is not personalistic, but metaphysical. Things about God and all the kind of informations in God. So what do you believe? I believe that God is one. I believe that God is Trinity. I believe that He came out in the world. Wherever you start with the that, I believe that, I believe that, I believe that. These are propositions, statements. And these statements are object of my faith, right? Today, this propositional faith is not having faith. I mean, it is having faith, but the fullness of having faith is not that. Having fullness of faith is living in relation to God for the fulfillment of His will. Don't say that I am living, loving God, I am living relationship with God and so on, then not concerned about His will. That would not be right. Are you living personal relationship with God or not will come to expression in your life. That is what I called spirituality earlier. I said, spirituality is living of faith. And a communist, an atheist may be living for the realization of God's plan and will. He may be living more the reality of faith than a Christian who does not care about the neighbor. He thinks only about multiplying his barn, putting more and more wheat and grain there, and then God asks next day, fool, you come back. What kind of fool he is? That fool is not a Christian. Christian is someone who knows the message of the cross. He knows that a grain of wheat must decay so that new plant will come out. And a new plant is the kingdom of God. It will come out into life only when I am living. It is not enough to keep things in mind. The rich man with the big barn, he may have all faith in his head. But he was not a faithful man. He was not a man of faith. So Christian is not someone who has all knowledge of faith and knowledge of God in the head, but who lives faith in history, in the world. Faith is not something to be lived in heaven. In heaven, you need not have what we call today here on earth, faith. You see God directly. There is no hope in heaven. You'd hear, everything is directly there. So on earth, these are all realities which have to be lived. So living of realities is more important than the propositions which I accept and which I live. So, personalistic revelation. How does this revelation take place?
God as a person who loves, He reveals Himself when He creates the world. An artist who creates something, he is expressing himself. He is revealing himself. He is revealing the joyful nature of himself when he brings out a joyful reality, something like that. Or he brings out something deep in human life when he brings out something which has got so many, he draws a picture or makes a song which resonates into the depths of human existence. Then he brings out something deep in him. So he reveals himself in all these ways. So God also reveals himself in this way, in different ways. And creation is one way of God the artist revealing himself. God is someone who has love, so much of love. Now we know from the background of our understanding of faith and so on, creation is a self-expression of God. God's self-gift to outside of himself, that is creation. And so creation is a way of God expressing himself. Revelation takes place through creation. Revelation takes place also through subjects, human subjects. So through creation, one thing, through human subjects, another way of revelation. Then through history, a third way of revelation, three ways of revelation, or three types of revelation. In mystical revelation, God's revelation takes place within the depth of the human person. He realizes himself as related to God, according to the Hindu terminology, as one with God. As according to the Christian terminology, we don't use the terminology of identification with God, as identity with God, but God as a person who loves us, and we as persons who love God, in intimate communion with one another, like father and children, communion. So that is expression through the self. In the Hindu understanding, we speak of mystical revelation and so on. So mystical revelation also is possible in Christianity as well. So mystical revelation is another possibility. In Hinduism, we have mainly this. In Jainism, they speak of Kaivalya, Kevala Jnana. In Buddhism, they speak of Nirvana. All this is mainly revelation of God through the self. So revelation of God through creation, revelation of God through self. Revelation of God through history, that is Christian understanding, Jewish understanding. God revealed himself, involving himself in history. For what? In order to get his people a life of fullness, from slavery to fullness, slavery to freedom, and fullness of life. So God involved in history. So from the Exodus event in Egypt, God guides them over the years, so 30, 40 years, and then comes to a land of milk and honey. Life is full of happiness, full of freedom and joy, fulfillment, dignity, human dignity. In Israel, slave like an animal, no freedom, nothing to eat, misery. God wants people to enjoy life in its fullness. God has revealed that in history. Therefore, we know God wants this. God does not want misery and slavery and suffering, sickness. God does not want all that. We know that from historical revelation. So there is revelation in creation, revelation through the self, and revelation through history. Revelation through creation is called cosmic revelation, can be called cosmic, cosmos. Then through the self can be called mystic revelation. And then through historic revelation. What is the relation between these three types of revelations? Are they contradictory to each other? Or are they complementary to each other? Revelations are complementary, they are not contradictory. The God who reveals through creation is the same God who reveals himself in history. God created the world, same God Yahweh liberated the Israelites from freedom, from slavery. The same God appears in the depth of the human being, as we see in the case of Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, and many other mystics. People today, there are many people who experience this mystical experience. Some of you may not recognize mystical experience as something wonderful you have heard, and therefore we think that we are not worthy enough to experience mystical revelation or mystical experience of God. It is not true. We don't call it mystical experience, that is all. Very often we all have mystical experience. For example, when you stand looking at the rains falling, the drops falling, and you just find yourself lost, the whole wonder of what is taking place. Where the raindrops, what are these? Where do they come from? A phenomenon. Your consciousness is fully engaged with the reality, and then there is something taking place in your consciousness. You get lost in that. Occasions, I suppose you have had that kind of occasions. That is one way mystical. Or you may have heard a beautiful music, and then your whole attention and whole thinking waves or kind of goes up, and you are no more in touch with the concrete things and so on. You are taken up by somebody or someone. You are somehow gripped by the reality of the beauty of the music sometimes. And hasn't that happened to you in your case? Well, nobody has called that as mystical experience. But experience of aesthetics, experience of art, experience of beauty is so close to mystical experience that you cannot distinguish between both. If you believe in God and you call the God, use the God language for speaking about it, it is mystical experience. If you are an atheist, but you have the same experience, therefore you will not call God for in reference to this. You will not use the God language in reference to this. So you will not call it a mystical experience. But then thing is the same. It can happen. So three kinds of revelations. The relation between revelations also are the same God revealing himself. So there is no need that we who have revelation through history should go and fight with the Hindus who do not have or who do not understand revelation as taking place in history. Same God. He has revealed himself to them in a manner which we also accept, mystical experience. We accept that, but then our difference is more pronounced because history is more emphasized.